Hi, this is Manos Brilakis from the Minneapolis Heart Institute and the Cardiovascular Innovations Foundation, presenting video 7.3 for the Manual of Percutaneous Coronary Interventions. This video discusses about target lesion selection and specifically about the timing of PCI, the selection of one or more lesions that need revascularization, and if there is more than one target lesion, the sequence with which revascularization should be performed. Determining the target lesion or target lesions, if there is more than one, is the seventh of the 14 steps of percutaneous coronary intervention and actually marks the transition from the diagnostic to the interventional part of the procedure. The key questions that should be asked to determine the target lesions are, first of all, whether coronary revascularization is needed or not. Not every patient with coronary lesions requires revascularization. If revascularization is indicated, whether it should be done with PCI or with coronary bypass graft surgery. And those first two questions were discussed in detail in video 7.1, as well as video 7.2 that discusses finding the ACS culprit lesion. But if PCI is selected, then the subsequent questions is, first of all, when PCI should be performed, on which lesions and in what sequence and with which techniques. The last part, which techniques, will be discussed in the remaining chapters of the book, but the first three questions will be addressed in this video. So first of all, when? What is the optimal timing of percutaneous coronary intervention? And this depends heavily on presentation. Specifically, it depends on whether the patient presents with an acute coronary syndrome or with stable ischemic heart disease. In patients who present with acute coronary syndromes, who have a culprit lesion with an ongoing ischemia, and the classic example is ST segment elevation myocardial infarction, immediate ad hoc PCI is indicated. Similarly, for non-ST elevation ACS patients, angiography and PCI is indicated early on. However, for patients who have stable ischemic disease and for non-culprit lesions in patients who do present with acute coronary syndromes, then there are different ways to revascularize. They can be done ad hoc, which means at the same time as diagnostic angiography, or they can be done at a later time as a staged procedure. And there are advantages and disadvantages on both ways. The key advantage of ad hoc PCI is that it minimizes myocardial injury. Therefore, the culprit lesions of acute coronary syndromes should be done early. And also, it is easier, faster, and avoids a second procedure. So it's overall more convenient for the patient and minimizes the need for repeat procedures and the need for obtaining second arterial access, getting another catheter, and all the related procedural steps. However, doing ad hoc PCI does have disadvantages as well. First of all, the dose of contrast and radiation is higher, whether this is done in the setting of diagnostic or after treating the culprit lesion in ACS. Also, doing it at the time of the index procedure leaves less time for planning, less time for discussing with the patient, and that is why for patients with complex coronary artery disease and complex high-risk lesions, it is in most cases best to stop and have a full discussion with the patient and his or her family. Also, doing ad hoc PCI can create scheduling issues. For example, tackling a complex lesion when there are several patients waiting for their procedure will create significant delays and frustration in the other patients as well. It also depends on whether the site in which the diagnostic angiogram is performed is capable of performing PCI, especially complex PCI. And also there's the disadvantage that many patients who undergo diagnostic angiography may not have had adequate pretreatment with antiplatelet agents. Everyone has aspirin, but not everyone has received a P2Y12 inhibitor. So all these factors should be taken into account before deciding on whether ad hoc PCI should be done or not. This is an example of a patient with stable ischemic heart disease with a complex distal left main trifurcation lesion. Those lesions should generally not be done ad hoc. This requires stopping the procedure, having a full discussion with the patient, and then bringing the patient back on a second occasion, there's less issues with radiation and contrast. There's also planning for hemodynamic support, as shown in this case. And everything is more smoother, and everyone is just more comfortable, and outcomes are going to be better. Now, in patients who have multiple coronary lesions, the next question is whether you should revascularize all the lesions at the same time as a single procedure or bring the patient back for a staged procedure. And that depends on several factors. The first one is the complexity of the remaining lesions after the initial lesion is revascularized, the presence of active ischemia or not. Once again, if the patient has ACS, they can have more than one culprit lesions, and if that is the case, then all culprit lesions should be treated at the time of the index procedure. It depends on contrast and radiation. It depends on whether a complication has happened. For example, a patient who has a perforation and multivessel coronary artery disease, in most cases it is best to stop after the perforation is treated and then bring them back for a staged procedure several weeks or months later. It also depends on the patient and operator fatigue. Late in the day with a tired operator may not be the best time for tackling complex multivessel PCI. And finally, it depends on the patient's preference. In patients with acute coronary syndromes, a key determinant of whether multivessel PCI should be done at the time of the initial procedure depends on the presence of cardiogenic shock. If there's cardiogenic shock, then only the culprit lesions should be treated at the time of the initial angiography, and the other lesions, if they need revascularization, they should be staged for a later time. The reason is the culprit shock trial that demonstrated that doing culprit lesion only PCI in cardiogenic shock patients with myocardial infarction was associated with better outcomes, less mortality or renal replacement therapy, compared to patients who had an immediate multivessel PCI. Regarding patients who have acute coronary syndromes, complete revascularization is generally indicated, but then the timing does not seem to matter much. For example, incomplete, about two-thirds, the randomized patients to complete or incomplete revascularization, about two-thirds of the patients underwent PCI of the non-culprit lesions during the index hospitalization, and about a third after the time of discharge. However, during the subsequent follow-up, both groups derived benefit from the revascularization. And that was true for the co-primary, the first and the second co-primary endpoints. Therefore, it does not matter whether the staged revascularization is done during the initial hospital stay in ACS patients or is done at a later time. There are some patients in whom staged revascularization is the best way to go. This is an example of a patient who presents with acute myocardial infarction due to occlusion of a saphenous vein graft. As a first stage, the vein graft was recanalized. However, there was an undilatable, a balloon undilatable lesion. The patient was discharged home and then came back a few weeks later, at which time PCI of the native coronary artery CTO was performed successfully, providing good long-term outcomes. Moving on to the next question about which lesions should be performed, should be recanalized in case there is more than one. And that depends on whether the lesions are culprit for acute coronary syndromes or not. So in general, if the patient comes with more than one ACS culprit, and sometimes this can be challenging to determine, and this is discussed in video 7.2, all the culprits should be treated during the index procedure. However, for the non-culprit lesions, and for patients with stable ischemic heart disease, then the lesions that should be treated are those who are functionally significant. Coronary physiology studies have repeatedly shown that there is no need for recanalization of lesions that are not causing ischemia. In terms of complete versus incomplete revascularization, this issue has been resolved for acute coronary syndrome, specifically ST elevation myocardial infarction patients, given the complete trial. There is less convincing data for patients with non-ST elevation ACS, as well as patients with stable ischemic syndromes. And in most cases, patients who undergo complete revascularization do have better outcomes, but at the same time, this may not be the result of revascularization itself, but of a better baseline anatomy and comorbidities compared to the patients who did not have complete revascularization. What is the sequence of doing multivessel PCI in more than one lesions need to be treated? As discussed, the culprit lesions for ACS should be done first. And once this is done, then for other lesions, if there is multiple lesions in the same coronary artery, typically the distal lesions should be done first, because putting a stent proximally and recrossing it can result in deformation of the proximal stent and need for repeat intervention in that lesion. Factors influencing the choice of sequence are lesion complexity, the use of contrast radiation, and then the options, the availability of other revascularization options. For example, patients who have a non-CTO and a CTO, most of the time they will have their non-CTO lesion treated first and then return for CTO recanalization, which is usually more complex and requires more careful planning. There's obviously always exceptions to the rules. This is an example of a patient with a proximal and distal RCA lesion. Typically, the recommendation is to treat the right coronary artery lesion first. However, in this case, it depends the selection of the lesion, because what we found is engaging the vessel had a significant dampening of the pressure. So actually we ended up revascularizing the proximal and ostial RCA lesion first and then the distal. And then finishing up about the techniques, this is a lot of considerations go into this decision, and this will be discussed in detail in the subsequent chapters of the book. So to summarize, in patients in whom coronary revascularization is indicated with percutaneous coronary intervention, the choice of timing depends mainly on their presentation. Patients who present with ACS, the L-culprit lesions are treated first. Then, if they have more lesions in addition to the culprit, those lesions can be done either at the index procedure or in a staged fashion. This does not seem to impact subsequent outcomes. If they have cardiogenic shock, the non-culprit lesion should definitely not be done at the time of the initial presentation, but should be done at a staged fashion. Which lesions should be treated? In general, lesions who are causing ischemia, and we're talking about the non-ACS culprit lesions, should be revascularized. Complete revascularization has been shown to be beneficial in STEMI patients. Less strong data for patients with non-STEMI as well as stable ischemic heart disease. Finally, the sequence of the revascularization depends on the location of the lesions and the presence of multivessel disease. If there are multiple lesions in a single coronary artery, typically the distal lesions are treated first. Thank you.